Why does it seem like every hood movie from the 1990s ends in tragedy, not good, just bad?
Because we were not allowed to have any happy endings in the 90s. It just didn't happen.
So that's what we're going to talk about today. Why so many of these movies end in tragedy. I'm Height.
And I'm Cherie.
And you've discovered Axiom Amnesia.
A lot of you requested that we cover this film, and I can't wait for us to talk about it. But first, we want to thank all of the supporters who helped to make this video possible. If you want your name to appear alongside these contributors, make a one-time donation via Cash App or click the thanks button on this video, or you can head on over to patreon.com/axiomamnesia or become a channel member by clicking the join button to enjoy all of the benefits of becoming a monthly subscriber. So it's funny because we had this idea, actually Height had the idea, about talking about why the 90s hood movies just never ended in a happy place. It's funny because Jamal Davis, as we were planning this video, made a comment on our South Central video, which will be linked in the description. I love this movie. It's underrated, and it actually had a positive ending. Most of the hood movies always have a tragic ending. And it's just so funny that this comment would come at the same time we were making a video about the same thing. Now, I don't know if I would say that South Central has a happy ending, so we might as well just start talking about South Central.
Yeah, so I guess that is the hood movie genre, is that it's a tragedy. But can you equate like a tragedy with an epic too?
Well, yeah, like the epic, like a long story over many years. Well, the hood movies are not always over many years, like a technically an epic would be. But I think you could. But hopefully an epic has like highs and lows.
Yeah, but no matter what, it just seemed like they all happen to be tragedies. And that is part of what makes the genre. So even if it gives you somewhat of this good release at the end, as if it is positive, it's still a tragedy in all that happened and in how it ended. Because in the end of South Central, you have Jimmy who's going back to juvie. You had a mother who's still on what she's on. You know, You have your boys on parole. Still, he changed his life around. You know, maybe we don't know, but that's where it is. And you still have Deuce and Ray Ray and them controlling the hood and doing whatever to the kids.
Right. And see, the thing about it is, it's like the ending of the 90s hood films was just like a quick snapshot in time. Like they show you for the 30 seconds where either they're having this feeling of relief, like in this in South Central, where he's like, OK, I was able to rescue Jimmy. I walk off. I'm going to try to take care of my son. But realistically, do we really know what happens after the camera stop rolling? We talk about this a lot in the movies, but like, did Jimmy just, you know, did this one move make Jimmy's life better? And all of a sudden everything is cured.
Yeah. But outside of that, like from just what's in the movie, Is it happy? Right. Because you could say that about almost any story, just decide or come up with what happens after. But in the movie itself, we see that the state.
Right.
Because all it was, OK, your boy done all this. He was basically possibly taken away from the mother. Mm-hmm. It wasn't explicitly stated. Right. But, you know, that's the state that we're in. That Bobby don't even have his son.
Right. Right.
But is the good part or the happy part is that he said, I'm going to save my son if it even takes my own life. And that's it. But to me, that's still a tragedy.
It is.
The happy part is that, well, at least my son ain't die or in a gang.
Well, and that's what I wanted to point to, because I feel like in these movies, well, what makes a good story is that you have to have some bad things. It wouldn't be a great story if it wasn't, you know, bad things happening that could be offset by the relief of when great things happen or when there's this ending. But I think in this case, like it was just the extremes of everything that could possibly happen bad for this kid from the very beginning of his life, you know, having an addicted mother and a father who was, you know, in them streets and locked up, you know, so
they were trying to make every story like this.
Anything that could go wrong went wrong. Like, It just was bad. And we see this over and over, even though this wasn't a 90s movie. You know, we saw it with Precious too, like the worst possible story that ever could get told. We have to, you know, sit through the tragedies that just befall the main characters over and over and over again.
Yeah. And I think that's what make it where you get this cathartic feeling at the end, is that any little shred of hope is good.
Yeah.
So then you can resolve the story.
Yeah, right. Exactly. You get that catharsis. You do get the catharsis because everybody's holding their breath. Like, is Jimmy going to actually, you know, with along with Ray, is he going to go with Ray Ray or is he going to go with his daddy? You know, and just for in case you are not familiar with this story, you'll be happy to know that we do have, and it's like 3 hours long, a full breakdown of this movie available on the channel that is linked in the description. But we know that, you know, most of you all who are the real ones have already seen this breakdown and have seen this movie and are familiar with what we're talking about. But if you didn't, that now is a good time after you finish this video to go and watch that. But yeah, I don't think the ending in South Central was so happy. It wasn't. It was just like, I survived. So that's the bar. That's the bar of the hood film.
Yeah.
You that, lived.
Right. So that's one example, mm-hmm. right? If we make a claim that this basically always happens, then we have to give other examples.
Okay. So that we talked about South Central. We're just going to go down the list of the movies that are the most talked about and, you know, to the least talked about. Probably one of the biggest ones people talk about is Boys in the Hood. And we, too, have done many a video and fan theory on Boys in the Hood. In fact, our last video was on Boys in the Hood. You can check that out. All of these will be linked in the description. But with Boys in the Hood, how does it end? It ends with Ricky being gone. Doughboy is gone.
And then on the screen, it says, oh, your boy went to Morehouse and Brandy was across the street at Spelman.
Right, right. So Trey and Brandy go to college and that is it. So like they got out and maybe they stayed as a couple, you know, and I don't know, maybe they got married or whatever at the end of it all. If we look years in the future.
But you know what was really unnecessary?
What?
For them to kill off Doughboy. It was over, right? He went, sat on the porch. They had that little discussion. But then they was like, nah, we just can't end it like that. We have to say that Doughboy was got.
Well, and let me just say this, because I really feel like it. But it's realistic that Doughboy got, right?
Yeah,
but I hated it for the movie. It's kind of like it made it good and bad at the same time. Yeah,
because you had Trey's arc, right? Trey had become whatever he became because of his father's influence, right? And then he got out the car.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And then you could have like a turnaround with Doughboy. It was like, yeah, I know why you got out the car, which we did have.
Right.
So Trey's story was over. There is no need to put on the screen that Doughboy got killed.
But okay, so let's just, because we talked extensively about this in the last video, the video that we just did about whether Doughboy and Fudge from Higher Learning could be really the same character, but just in an alternate universe, right? The idea that Fudge is who Doughboy could have been given a different environment, different circumstances, right? And let me just stop and say here, when we talk about stuff in these movies and about these movies and videos, we are well aware of what happens in the movie. I cannot mention the number of people who said, no, it's not possible because Doughboy died at the end of Boys in the Hood. Yeah, we came into that knowing this, right?
Yeah.
We knew that he died. We're asking you a deeper question.
No, you know what I find? It's actually stupid that someone would make a comment without even watching the first 10 seconds of the video, because we basically say what's going on in the first 10 seconds. So for somebody to just come and put a comment, they just seem like the lowest amongst us, the least amongst us.
Well, I just, so it was so annoying. So many people had said it to the point where I was like, okay, I have to pin a comment to address this because I'm not going to individually mention this to each person. It that just was more than I could bear in the moment.
But
now, this doesn't apply to most of you. We know most of you watch, you understand what we do here. You don't come to the table thinking that somehow, you know, we're idiots who are just, you know, throwing something out with no support.
We're in a time when people will make a comment on something they know absolutely zero about because you didn't listen to one word of what we said. Makes zero sense.
Yeah. And so, you know, so fair warning that if you are in this, see, if you're listening to this point of the video, you're not one of these people. But if you are one of those people, you know, you've just been fair warned. Like, I'm not even going to engage with you like that in the comments, because, you know, I want to have fruitful conversations like with the people who are listening right now, not people who are just like, no, you know. Or how about the other part where you come to disprove? Right. You come to say that what we say is wrong and you haven't even listened. It makes you look really, really silly when we've laid everything out. Don't you think we anticipate the objections? Anyway, I'm off my soapbox. We're talking about Boys in the Hood. It was a bittersweet ending. I can't even say that I felt any sense of like relief, because I was sad that Doughboy was gone. Yeah. I was sad that Ricky was gone.
Yeah.
And I always knew, I always felt like a new Trey was going to make it anyway. But now that I think about it, like, what if Ricky and Doughboy had survived and Trey had got God?
Man.
That might have made a good movie.
Yeah, it would have been super tragic.
We're going to have to make a video of that. But just know that right now, this is the timestamp. Because, see, we got to have timestamps because people like to steal our ideas. We'll get to that more later. But yeah, like, that's something that I think would be interesting to explore. What if Trey, you know, was the one? Yeah. What if Trey was Ricky in that alley? Ooh, you know that Furious wouldn't just, it just would have been a mess. Because just imagine all the implications, right? The implications of Trey's mother letting him go live with the father feeling like, well, only a man could raise a man. And then under your tutelage and watch, Trey gets God.
Yeah, it's kind of what we talked about, where it basically Trey was just one step away from basically not being the good guy, right? Mm-hmm. If he just stayed in the car a little longer, you would have been right there when this thing took place.
That's true.
Or if they would have found him earlier, he would have been in the car.
Right, right. And, you know, but I think that's it exemplifies what real life is like when the company you keep is into whatever they're into, you know, like it doesn't take much for you to get roped into, you know, the repercussions of it. So another movie that people always talk about, 90s hood movie, classic that we've done so much on. I think we might have more videos on this movie than any other one. Menace to Society. Now, was the ending? Okay, let me, before we even get started. First thing we have to say about Menace to Society is a lot of you probably are watching this video now. And if you're new, you might have found this channel because of our original fan theory on Menace to Society, where we suggest that O-Dog is Kane's alter ego. We suggested that more than 2.5 years ago.
It's a fan theory that we put out first. People saw and go around and basically
on TikTok or wherever, even on YouTube,
just repeat it
in comments, repeating it.
Yeah.
And let me just set the stage before we get into it. Imagine that you put this fan theory out. You put all this work into it. Because we didn't just make a claim. Hey, what if this? No, we showed you directly from the film evidence of why this could be true. Right.
Yeah. And a lot of the times how it starts is somebody said, oh, dog and Kane, we said.
After almost 30 years of watching this movie, we noticed something about the characters Kane and O-Dog that was in our faces the entire time. What if wild and crazy O-Dog wasn't actually a real person, but was instead Kane's alter ego? I know, you already want to say this is impossible, but let us explain all of the clues in the movie that add up to the very plausible alternate theory that O-Dog wasn't an actual person. Oh yeah, and Kane doesn't actually die at the end of the movie either. And we'll tell you all about that too. Yeah, we Axiom Amnesia said it. And in addition to that, we just had a comment this within the last couple of days where somebody came in and was like, y'all should do something on the on how O-Dog is Kane's alter ego.
Yeah.
Really? It's just, you know, but whatever. Again, we'll mention it. If you to discuss and talk about stuff that ideas other people came up with, you should give attribution. When we get ideas from other places, we mention that. I mean, like, what's wrong with that? Not so that we can, quote unquote, get the credit, but just so that people know.
Yeah.
you know, people know where the idea came from. But like, just imagine we're over here doing our thing and people come into our channel telling us that somebody else's idea, our you idea belongs there, to them.
Yeah. You didn't heard this guy on TikTok say something and you waiting on him to come with another creative original thought and it never comes because he didn't tell you what a creative original thought originated. Right. Exactly. So that you can be there for the creative for the creative thoughts. But
yeah, he didn't say that. But see, what I do know is that we have ideas that will always come. We'll always have a new idea. But, you know, the people who just steal ideas from other people and then talk about them like they're their own, or and not just steal, because think about this, right? If you say, oh, it's Kane's alter ego or whatever, right? And then you want to tweak something in our fan theory, and then you say, well, my theory is, no, that's not your theory either. That's just our fan theory that you changed one element of, and then try to say, come on now, y'all. Just be real. Just all we're saying is just give credit where credit is due. But we know that most of you don't do this. So this is our soapbox. But let's talk about Menace to Society. We have Old Dog and we have Kane. We're not talking about the fan theory version of this movie. Okay?
And if you don't know what a fan theory is, it's kind of, well, it's just, it complicates things. But in the end, you had Kane, the star, the main character, right? Tyron Turner get offed, basically.
Yeah.
And that was it. Like, what?
And he's like, oh, I do care if I live or die. Boom, that's it. And then you see O-Dog get arrested in some of the
And Sharif
scenes.
Got off, too.
Right. Sharif got knocked off. And yeah, it just was a calamity, right? Definitely not a happy ending. Certainly a cautionary tale. And there's no way that you walk away from Menace to Society feeling good. You walk away feeling like, dang.
Yeah, but I think that's a way to do things if you have like a message or a moral, right?
True.
If you end it in tragedy and be like, this could be your ending. And I think that's why this happens so much.
And it's not a criticism, actually. I think that Menace to Society ended the way it needed to end. I don't think anything should have been changed about how it ended, like, because there's consequences. You know, if Kane got off and then certainly, you know, was in Atlanta with Ronnie, like after all that had happened, you know, where is the karmic retribution for what he put out into the world? So I do think it ended the way. Now, what I find interesting, because I was looking at AWACS on the screen, I find it interesting that AWACS makes it like he somehow is the guy, even though we talked about, and we did a full breakdown of this in addition to our fan theory on this, which is something separate. We did a full breakdown of the movie, so you can check that out. Description, you know, link is in description. But we do talk about like how AWACS was like the supervisor. AWACS was the boss kind of the little crew. He was the preceptor, the one teaching them the ways, teaching them how to do the drive-bys and all the stuff that they were doing, you know. And but AWACS in the end, AWACS survives as far as we know.
Until, you know, that's the thing about like with movies and stories is you always have these dangling stories at the end, or the characters dangling, like you don't know what happens to him. What even happens to Old Dog? You know, okay, maybe he gets life, maybe he gets juvenile life, you know, you don't know.
Right.
Like, does he actually, I don't know. It's just when you have those stories like that, but that is the art of storytelling, where you weave these stories and then at the end, you're not even thinking about what happened to the other people.
Right.
You're just like, we were shown the stories of these main characters, which is kind of why Boys in the Hood, the ending is kind of, we didn't care about Brandy at the end, right? You don't care, but you throw it on the screen. Oh, look what happened to Brandy.
Well, we only care. You didn't tell me what happened to because, you know, now we know Trey had a companion. When he had Atlanta.
Yeah, that's it. But what happened to Ricky's baby mama, Ricky's kid, that sort of a thing. So when you throw that in there, it kind of makes you realize that some strings were left unattached, I guess you would call it.
Yeah.
So, but when you have a good story and you just got this character right here, you see what happened to him. Dang, that was crazy. Because Ronnie's right there. She could have went to Atlanta. Maybe she didn't go after this. Who knows?
I think Ronnie went to Atlanta on the first same thing day. Smoking.
She didn't even wait for the ambulance to show up. She just got in the van and was like,
she was like, her and that little boy was out. Because, you know, at the end of the day, I guess from Ronnie's perspective, the way that movie ended was kind of like, look, you're lucky that your child was able to get away with his life, because Cain essentially saved the life of the baby. So at the end of the day, your kid lived. If you spend another night in LA or wherever they were at the if you spend another night there, you crazy. Get out of town and just keep it moving. And I think that's what Ronnie would have done, you know. But final thought on Menace to Society, I'll say it definitely was not a happy ending, but it was the ending that it needed to have. And if you doubt anything that we mentioned about our Menace to Society fan theory, all you got to do, if you want to know who said something first, is just look at the date that the video was posted. The proof is in the pudding. So let's keep it moving. Poetic justice.
Bruh.
We've done a few videos on poetic justice and whatnot, but we know that at the end of poetic justice, what happens is Lucky and Justice meet back up when Lucky stops by Justice's salon, and they smile, and we're left to believe that, you know, they get together and everything is hunky-dory from there on out. Now, we did a video kind of talking about what happened after the camera stopped rolling. But this is one of the endings, I would say, that kind of tricks you into believing it could be happy, right? Because it's that split second where everything is, all the stars of the sun and the moon are aligned and everything is perfect, right? It's just that split second. That's it. You know, but then we know that Lucky and Justice was probably arguing the next day, the same day, maybe even.
Yeah. And it's just that. I don't know if that story was a good story. We haven't done a full breakdown on that. And, you know, it's a bunch of stuff we didn't talk about the movie. I don't know how good the story is.
If you think we need to do a full breakdown on Poetic Justice, go ahead and put Breakdown Poetic Justice as your comment right now.
So what is the movie about?
The movie is about a trip over the course of a day or two where two people who were at odds with each other in the beginning realize their need for what the other person brings to the table, and they quote unquote fall in love.
But it's supposed to be about Janet Jackson's character, right? Justice really, because that's who they kind of follow.
Right. From the beginning when her boyfriend is killed and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. But then by the end, it's like, okay, now Lucky is coming back, right? It's for him because he lost his cousin, went crazy, and now I need to go make up with this girl, right? Mm-hmm. Not that she has to overcome something. All she got to do is overcome him being mad at her.
Well, and then, you know, when it comes to Lucky, like, what level of responsibility did he gain over this? Okay, when you look at him as a father, because he had the young child whose mother was like either the hoe or a crackhead or something, like she was doing something strange for a piece of change right there in the apartment with the little girl there, and he was like, I'm taking my baby to be with my mama. He didn't say I'm taking my baby. It kind of reminds me of Baby Boy, right? I'm not taking my baby to go take care of my child myself, but I recognize the child doesn't need to be in this environment, but I'm not going to take the full responsibility for the kid.
So here, mama, you got to raise a kid.
Here, mama. And his mother, was played by Jennifer Lewis, was like, you know, the nurse. And his mama was like, don't be thinking you're going to be laying your kids on me. But she's working shifts at the hospital and you laying this kid, you know, you trying to put your... So when you think about that mindset and then him, and then, okay, so he had his girl, he brought her. But you're just looking for somebody to take care of your baby too.
Yeah.
You know.
But so his cousin died.
Yeah.
I guess they got together and then they broke up.
Mm-hmm.
And then the happy ending is
reconciliation.
Reconciliation. Because it ain't like, okay, love is back, right? And in traditional, more like romance stories, it's that you have this bond by the end, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or that you had a great bond to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the end, you know, you got the baby, please. You know what I'm
begging.
Saying?
Right.
But this was, one weekend, y'all got together, had a big fallout, got called a bitch and everything.
And the thing is, it was right on the heels of his cousin, you know, tragically losing his life. So he's emotionally charged, and, you know, the argument could be said that he kind of don't know what he's really saying. He's just, you know.
Yeah, but it don't matter.
But that was why they fell out. Like, it wasn't something that was like she did a thing. And then, you know.
It
was all about
think
him.
About in real life. If you meet somebody one weekend and then they just blow up at you because they found out somebody died. Like, you still ain't going to have the same grace you would have for somebody who you've known for a month. And then you find out that, okay, their cousin died and something caused them to, you know, lash out at you.
Right.
It's just not the same. It's like, yeah, I understand, but I only known you for 2 days. Really, it was 1 day.
I mean, so he had met her at the when he was delivering mail.
Yeah, and it take about 8 hours, yeah, you know, to travel that far.
Then he sees her again when they get ready to go on a trip the next day, or yeah, sometime soon after, right? So they didn't really know each other. They just had a little piece of chemistry after after Lucky beat up Chicago for her.
But that's, was it a tragic ending? I think this one could have fallen under this. It was a happy ending.
It wasn't happy though. It wasn't happy. It was just everybody survived. It was just baseline. Exactly. It was baseline. But like, because our lives tend to be so tragic and full of all of this crap because of the socioeconomic circumstances, then we look at just surviving as, man, that was a happy ending.
Yeah,
no,
we're
that's
cordial.
That
was
that's
how
somebody
it
else's
it.
Baseline.
Yeah.
You know.
Let me do your daughter's hair.
Oh, man, look at that. You know, like, but it's all in how you perceive what happened, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know. Y'all, let us know in the comments. Do you think Poetic Justice was a happy ending, or was it just like a okay ending? Like things were just okay, status quo. You know, how do you view the ending? And do you think that Lucky and Justice stayed together or not? All right. So the next movie we should talk about
is what?
Set It Off. Set It Off. I suggest y'all remember that song when it came out. That was on the
Yeah, it's popular again because they like to do dance to it.
So, mm-hmm. Yeah. So Set It Off, you know, which in case you don't know, is the story of four friends who had all these terrible things happen to them that lead to them wanting to commit some bank robbery so they can get some money to improve their life. Right. And the end of Set It Off, the only one who makes it is Stoney, who is Jada Pinkett's character.
Yeah.
The other three women.
It was T.T., Cleo.
T.T. and
Frankie.
Frankie, yes. So the other three characters, you know, met their end as a result of things that happened with the robberies. You know, basically they all got shot up.
It's kind of like everybody in these movies are collateral damage, right? If you couldn't have a happy ending. Because you have Stoney, who got away because it was kind of her story where, okay, she was doing this stuff for her brother, you know, what you say, mm-hmm, doing a little something strange for some change for her brother to go to college.
Nate, I need a bind, Nate.
If you don't know, police took him out. Mm-hmm. And then she's like, hey, we all together, we gonna make this money. She the only one who get away. Everybody else is just done for. And it doesn't matter. I'm happy that she left with this money. But then she's crying over the money. So that's not that happy. She found love, I guess.
It's not a happy ending because 75% of them died.
Yeah.
Man, 75% of the crew
She found
dead.
Love and she still didn't get to be with him.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't even get that companionship or nothing. You don't get the companionship of your friends. You just got money and that's the moral that I'm telling you, right?
The happy ending
money
is survival.
Is,
that's
yeah,
it.
Yeah. Money can't bring you happiness.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, I'm teaching y'all, right? We didn't do a breakdown on this one either,
but
that's basically what the movie
is. Yes.
That's basically the end of the movie. Money don't bring you happiness, but they were trying to. Yeah, I guess this is not the time to talk about what actually happened in the movie. But yeah, what did they rob these places for happiness or kind of what they perceived as happiness?
They robbed it to get the money to get out of the very unhappy circumstances they were in. You know, TT's baby was in the system. She trying to get her baby back. Stoney just didn't care no more because her brother was dead pretty much. And they all working as custodians for Luther.
Yeah.
You know, so.
And Cleo just money corrupts.
Money.
Right?
Yeah, money it's corrupts. Like... And then Frankie, you know, needed the money because she had been fired from her job as a bank teller after the place got robbed by somebody from the hood who she knew.
And I think a pivotal scene is when they're sitting on the roof and they're looking at the factories and like, they pay $15 an hour over there. You know, I'd be like, mm-hmm, oh, what you need, boss? And all that sort of thing. It's like this aspirational thing. If all we had some money, then things would be fine. You would do whatever for the money and you crying over money in the end.
Yeah. So to me, it was just at best, it was, hey, I'm
it was, hey,
at least one of them survived.
That's what I was about to say. At least one of them got away.
But that ain't happy. That ain't what we could
happy.
Call happy. So then the next movie we should talk about is Jason's lyric. Now, we also did a fan theory on Jason's lyric, you know, and the fan theory suggested that basically it's not as it seems. At the last scene of Jason's lyric, or close to the last scene, we see Jason and Lyric on a bus, and it's looking like after everything tragic that has happened, you know, in the straight way of things, you know, Josh is gone, and now Jason and Lyric can be together, and they're on this bus on their way to Dallas. But our fan theory said...
Our fan theory did what every other movie did.
Yes. Our fan theory said that they were on the highway to heaven. They were not. They were dead and whatever. And if you want to watch the video for our fan theory, it's linked in the description. We won't give it too much away. But we do have evidence from the film as to why this is. Even though I know you want to object as soon as you hear this theory, just listen to the evidence and see what you think. Anyway, so that's separate, though, from the broad interpretation of the film, what most people think happened in the film. So at the end of the film, and that's what we're going to discuss now, just the regular ending, is that Lyric and Jason are on this bus and they get to go and start a whole new life somewhere else. Was that happy? Is that a happy ending?
No. So first off, they were running from stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And that kind of thing is like all you're doing is you're avoiding whatever you have. So I don't find that happy ever. But I guess a new start would be. But in the end, what really happened was Jason died. Mama fired.
Mm-hmm.
His mama lost a job after however many years it was.
And, or did she lose her job?
Josh,
or was she just...
Josh died.
I don't think she lost her job. I think it was just that her drawer had never come up short and Josh went up in there and was still in her job after she got her son a job at her place of business. Yeah.
At Frenchie's. But I don't know. I think she got fired for that.
Maybe she did. Let us know in the comments. Did Jason and Josh's mama actually get fired, or was it just, you know... Her pride was hurt because her drawer was short.
If your pride hurt for that, then that's
well, you
a
know,
whole
the mama was
discussion.
Upstanding because when Josh came in with that nice meal that he bought with that drug money, she threw that meal in the garbage. So, you know,
yeah.
It wouldn't be above her character. So the ending of this movie, I would say, is sad. You know, it's sad because, like you said, they are running. You're hopeful for the young love, but like when you think of it as realistic. In a real world, people who come together under these circumstances of duress and whatever, like, what did they really have? What do you have when now Josh, who was like the antagonist, is out of the situation? What do you have
when her brother
when your brother is not in the situation because you've left? So it's just the two of y'all now. It's just quiet. But see, they never had that situation before. So I don't really know. And they were young.
Yeah.
I don't even know.
And how long was it? Because that's a big part of it for me. When they're telling these stories, it just be these short loves, like Titanic. I don't know why I brought it up, but you know, it's just, sounds good, but.
But would it have really worked? So let us know. Do you think that Jason's lyric was an actual happy ending? Let us know that in the comments. So the next movie that we should discuss is New Jack City. All right. At the end of New Jack City, we see that pretty much a lot of people have get taken out. But at the end, it is who that is on that stairwell that gets taken out by the old man?
Oh, who, Nino?
Yep, Nino Brown. So the old man takes out Nino Brown. That's the ending of the movie. But was this happy that he took him out? Was everybody, like when you watch this, were you happy? I wonder, because a lot of people seem to idolize Nino, would the people who idolize Nino be sad that this, you know, badass character in their minds is gone?
Huh.
Even though he just did some treacherous things. He was horrible. By the way, we do have a fan theory on New Jack City as well, which will be linked in the description. I don't know. Were you happy that Nino Brown got God at the end of New Jack City?
I guess I was, right?
Mm-hmm.
But do most people, the people who idolize Nino Brown, are they happy about that ending?
Well, for me, it was bittersweet. Like, I was happy for the old man's win because I feel like he did that vigilante justice for the community, right? But then I was not happy for the police's win, if you will, right? Because I just feel like they were corrupt and all, whatever. And I did, you know, but they won by default because of the fact that Nino got, but they were about to lose because Nino was about to get off or whatever.
Yeah. But in the story, what's the happy ending? Is the story is Scotty wanting to take down Nino.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if you get a happy ending in it, unless you're a cop.
Well, Scotty won.
Yeah, but that don't make it happy for me.
Yeah.
Maybe for somebody else, but that ain't happy.
Go to the comments. Was New Jack City a happy ending?
Because Nino explained it to you, right? He's like, oh, it ain't just him. He don't bring all this stuff in. You took him out, and then you still have the, I guess it was the Russians over there or the Italians. I can't even remember. The mafia or whoever it was.
He was in trouble, but that's what I would say about New Jack City. Another 90s movie is the movie Belly. And you know what? Y'all gonna laugh, but I had to rack my brain and think about, like, how did Belly even end?
I don't even remember.
So my recollection, y'all help us in the comments. My recollection of the ending of Belly is that T-Boz's character and Nas's character go off to Africa because they were talking about they were going, you know, everything was going to go down. Then they was going to be able to get away and escape to Africa. That was like the ending. And, you know, then they had the other plot line, storyline, you know, the storyline with DMX, where he was kind of like the trying to get the Nation of Islam like leader, you know. You know, getting caught up in the storyline. You know, y'all probably gonna be salty. Belly was not that great of a movie, but it was visually interesting.
Yeah. And yeah, I don't know. I can't even tell you if it was a happy ending or not.
But so, y'all, we have just, to defer to you all whether it was a happy ending.
How could
you
be happy when they were so dry?
Yeah.
Nas was extra dry. T-Boz was dry. So, like, they were like, we going to go to Africa.
Yeah.
Let's go to Africa.
I mean, so this is one of those things where the acting contributes, or the lack thereof of acting skill, and the writing and the storyline itself can contribute. Now, I will say the storyline, parts of it could have been interesting and well played. You know, this movie was directed by Hype Williams, who had been famous in the 90s for doing all those music videos and stuff. And it was really kind of filmed like a very long music video, the movie was. But I mean, I feel like Belly is just one of those things where it's just the good cult classic of hood film. And you just should know Belly. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
if somebody brings it up, you should know what's up with Belly for 90s
but
films.
What about Tyron Turner in Belly?
Okay. So Tyron Turner, who, you know, was the star of Menace to Society, he starred as Kane, is in Belly, and
he plays Big.
So he's, you know, in that scene, and he's chewing the banana. He just makes a fool of himself.
He said, you know, he done some of the best acting of his life in that role, right? But he said that he was trying to sabotage it because I guess he thought he was supposed to be top billing and stuff because, you know, he was Kane.
And that was him trying. Part.
That was him trying to sabotage the movie.
But
and he became an iconic character.
Yeah, made the character way, 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 way better. But yeah, Belly, I don't know. It just, yeah, I mean, I guess if going off to Africa is your happy ending. But even when you think about, like,
what you running from?
What are you running from again? And the reality of, we're going to go to Africa, like, that, people don't even understand what that means to, like, leave and not really have intentions of coming back. So everybody who you know, all your family, all your everything, because see, in the movies, they never really talk about your family, right? They just focus only on whoever the main characters are.
Even in the ones immigrating to the U.S., they never really talk about
it's
that.
Like, but you never, the sacrifice is great. And any of you all who might be immigrants or might not be living where you were born and are, you know, estranged, not even just estranged from your family, but there's just distance. That you know, like, that is a huge, huge deal to move all the way to an entirely different country and be away from your family.
And it's different if it's like, things are so bad here, I don't like it here, I'm gonna go to Africa, versus like, okay, I live this lifestyle, you know what I'm saying, I'm culturally like this and this is my heritage, mm-hmm. and now I just ended up in Africa.
Yeah,
right. Those are two different things.
So let's talk about Friday, which is a comedy, so it should have a happy ending.
Yeah.
The first Friday movie, to be specific. What are we talking? So at the end of the first Friday movie, Debo gets knocked out and Craig is there.
Yeah.
Knocking him out.
And
they get away from Big Worm.
And they get the money back.
Yeah.
I think that movie was really, really well written.
Mm-hmm.
Like, because, you know, when you have these movies, you have all sorts of things that's happening. You had the thing with Debo. You had a thing with Felicia, Nia Long's character, you know, all of this. Smokey, Ezell.
Right.
And it all ties back together. And even Red's story ties back. You know, he shows up out of nowhere and gets his bike. But mm-hmm. I think it was well written, but I think, yeah. They got to smoke weed, got the money that they stole from Stanley, paid off Worm, and...
So it was a happy ending. So we have found one out of, like, all the movies we talked about so far that we could both agree is an actual happy ending. So I guess, I don't know, should we change the title?
No.
The hood movies never have a happy ending. So,
no,
you
because,
know, it's a generalization.
Yeah, it's a figure of speech.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, I would say Friday. But then Friday is a comedy, right? Whereas some of the other movies that we're looking at would be more of drama.
Yeah, tragedy.
Tragic. Yeah, basically. So the next one, which of course we know doesn't have a happy ending, is Tales from the Hood. By the way, about Friday, the first movie, we did do a full breakdown of the movie Friday, which is available on the channel and will be linked in the description. So Tales from the Hood. We did multiple videos breaking down each of the stories. We're talking about the first Tales from the Hood. Each of the, I guess they're vignettes or stories from Tales from the Hood. And the overarching kind of story was definitely not a happy ending when you find out that you're in hell with the devil.
Maybe if you're like, they got what they deserved.
Mm.
Maybe that's happy. But it shows... the devil winning, so maybe if Satan's your boy, then it's happy.
Then it's happy ending for you. Oh my goodness. Yeah, so that's Tales from the Hood. Like, I think the that's pretty shut, open and closed.
What about page. Each story, though? Okay, we got Walter's story, where the monster gets twisted up.
Yeah.
That's not happy. You got Clarence, the cop, that's not happy.
So on some levels, though, okay, let's go back to when the little boy and, you know, and his abuser is twisted up at the end. Like, isn't that happy, though, for the little boy? Because he's triumphant. He gets to win over this monster. But I mean, maybe.
He's traumatized for life because if you see that in real life, you toe up, man.
You're probably traumatized from just getting beat, so.
Yeah, but this was just, that's something totally different. He's seen something nobody ever sees. Like, you don't see nobody twisted up and burnt like that, bro.
Yeah, it was pretty gross. Then what were the other things? Okay, the one with the dolls. The dolls got
that was a happy
back.
Ending. That was happy. We had one of the stories had a happy
and
ending.
Crazy K.
Crazy K kind of lined
sad.
Up with this one.
Yeah.
And, with the main story.
Uh-huh. And then what was the other one?
That was it. Clarence. The
Clarence,
cop.
Yeah. That was sad, though.
Yeah.
You know.
He was in a mental institute. Right. So,
definitely not a happy ending to me. All right. Another movie. I admit that I cannot remember. And you guys have been asking for us to cover this. We will cover this movie at some point. New Jersey Drive.
Yeah. So we just watched this movie not that long ago. I forgot how it ended. So New
you
Jersey Drive
both.
Ended with, I think, did he snitch on a cop? In New Jersey Drive, you had Jason and his homeboys. And basically, one by one, they got taken out. And it was a crooked cop who was trying to set Jason up. And then at the end, he's sitting in a classroom.
The final scene features Jason sitting in a classroom, earning his education and reflecting on the past.
Yeah, they just got taken out one by one.
Yeah, and the only one who survives is Jason, and he goes back to school. Again, a baseline ending. Like, he survived everything, which is amazing, and it is good. But, like, his life never should have been that in the first place. So he survives. And then he goes to school. But how many other people were already in school? That's not a happy ending.
Yeah,
just doing what is the baseline status quo thing.
I wonder how you get back in school and all that stuff. Because, man, there was some stuff going on.
They got them alternative programs.
Yeah.
that can get you straight. But yeah, so I wouldn't call that a happy ending. That's one of those status quo kind of endings. But it's also sad because everybody else, like, you know, all the rest of the characters got died or, you know, had bad things happen to them.
Yeah, it was not good.
So the next movie that we'll talk about, which we did a full breakdown that we did multiple videos on, is Above the Rim. Which is the story of an aspiring basketball player and his struggles and blah, blah, blah. But at the end of Above the Rim, what happens is Shep, who is the ex-basketball player, and Kyle, the young player, is kind of his protege to some extent in this movie. Shep takes a bullet that is sent by Tupac's character, Birdie.
Yeah.
Or a guy that Birdie sends anyway. Played by Avon Barksdale.
Shut up, Wood Harris.
Wood Harris, yes. And so he takes a bullet for him, and then at the end of the movie, Kyle gets to go to Georgetown, which has been his aspiration all along, and play basketball.
Yeah, that's kind of happy, but you had something to happen. I guess it could still be happy, because what the one who sent the bullet, Birdie, he got taken out by Kyle's best friend, Boogaloo, who at the beginning of the movie, they showed how important he was when he got out. He left his home, his new homeboys and stuff, to go hang out with Boogaloo and all of this. And yeah, Boogaloo just sacrificed himself. And the placement of that isn't too far from the ending, right? Mm-hmm. So I just seen this happen. And then you think the movie's over. And then now let's show the happy ending. Like, it's like this wasn't there, and the studio was like, nah, man, you got to add something to make it happy. So then it showed him playing for Georgetown.
And everybody being happy is his coach, Shep, who, by the way, is dating his mama now, you know. And I guess maybe it qualifies as a happy ending.
I think it's happy ending.
Tell us in the comments, is Above the Rim a happy ending type of movie or not?
Like I said in that breakdown, if y'all go watch it, the movie should have been about Shep, even though it really was.
It would have been a better movie if it really was focusing on Shep. But I think because the demographic that was going to see the film was younger, you know, they didn't really want to focus on an older
character.
This
old man.
Yeah. So the next movie we should talk about is Higher Learning, which we also have a full breakdown of, which, by the way, has been unfortunately demonetized because, you know, we're going to talk about the issues at hand, and sometimes platforms
YouTube don't
like
that.
Right. So, Higher Learning, you know, it tells the story of these different storylines of college students who are going through their thing. But like the main character is Malik, played by Omar Epps. And at the end, Deja, his girlfriend, gets taken out. And then what happens after that is Malik decides
starts running.
Yeah, he basically seems to say that he's not going to come back to school the next semester, because that's the big question. Are you going to continue with your education here at this school?
Yeah.
And that's it. I mean, it was a very sad ending. Deja got. I mean, there's no reason that a young
definitely
college
not
student,
a happy ending.
Yeah, it was sad. And then sad that he is doing something other than what he wanted to be doing, that this event tragedy that happens that makes him take a different course.
You know what? When we decided to do this topic, I thought it would be more that had happy endings. I was just like, yeah, most of the time, but this seemed almost everyone is just That's really what makes the movies good.
Well, maybe Fudge had a happy ending, Ice Cube's character, because he did graduate and he was a super duper
like you
senior,
say, how many people do that?
A lot.
Well, I guess it's not about a bunch of people doing it, but he was basically on his way anyway, so that part's not happy. It just was going to take him some time.
Yeah, he was going to graduate. He'd been there 6 years. He was making it happen.
Did your boy steal this from House Party too?
I don't know.
That's basically what's happening. I'm going to have to drop out of school. But then I think he came back because he got the money. But
well, but you know what? That's such a common common thing, right? You know, how am I going to pay for my education?
But this story didn't matter. It's none of that. Like, we didn't need that.
Well, no, we needed for Malik to know that he had to give up a pound of flesh in order to keep his scholarship.
Yeah,
and that was an important part of the story.
Part of it could have been that him realizing you don't need this sort of an education, right? Or coming to the realization is this education really worth what you have to pay for it?
The price, yeah. Not just monetary, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, to me, higher learning, definitely not a happy ending. Next movie, The Wood. Yeah, The Wood came out in 1999. It barely made the cut of the 90s movies. But, you know, in The Wood, of course, is the kind of coming of age flashback of, you know, main character Roland getting married and the flashback to him and his guys when they were, you know, in high school and in junior high and girls that they liked and blah, blah, blah. So at the end of the movie, basically the main thing that's happening is Roland is getting cold feet, not sure he's run away because he's not sure if he wants to be married and his bride is waiting and all of this and that. So at the end, Roland gets married and Mike, who's played by Omar Epps and Sanaa Lathan, reunite and maybe rekindle their love at the wedding years later, because Mike and Alicia are, you know, no longer. Well, they didn't keep in touch over the years, I don't think.
That was the happy ending.
The wedding. The happy ending was basically them having a chance to be together or rekindle something. And then the happy ending of everything working out because the wedding happened, even though, you know, maybe if you got to run away the day of the wedding, should you really be getting married?
So Roland planned on getting married. And then he decided, I'm getting married. And that's the happy ending. And Mike getting to talk to Alicia and dance with her.
And we did ask some questions along the way, like when we, because we did talk about The Wood a little bit. I think we have a video. Do we have a couple videos about The Wood or something like that? I know we've talked about The Wood. And oh, we did a full breakdown of The Wood.
Yeah.
Oh, my bad. Hello. A full breakdown of The Wood is available in the description. So, yeah. So The Wood, basically, to me, is asking the question, A, should they have gotten married? And we do ask, like, do you really think that Roland's marriage lasted, considering, you know, what all he went through to, you know, to get married that day and what it took for him to get down the aisle? And we also ask, do people think that Alicia and Mike, you know, like, because they were living on different coasts, did Alicia come back to California? You know, did they, or was it just a one weekend fling when she came back, if anything? And then that was that, and they moved on. What was that? So
I guess you could classify this as happy, though.
A happy ending with foreseen problems in the near future.
But even like their speech that they gave at the end, the best man, it wasn't even happy. It was just like bittersweet. Yeah, we've been friends and stuff, and I'm so happy to be and know that we're still friends.
All I could think about was losing my brother, but I realized I'm gaining a sister. You know, that was kind of what the deal was. So I guess I would vote for The Wood being a happy ending.
Yeah.
And it was a great film. So just because the ending isn't happy doesn't mean the movie isn't good.
Yeah.
I think it was the resolution was really good. I did enjoy just the nostalgia of it.
Well, maybe in the future we'll do a different video about which endings are good and which ones are not.
Yeah.
Go to the comments. Let us know if you want to see that.
What's the worst movie ending, 90s hood movie ending, in your opinion? Tell us in the comments. So The Wood, and you might as well say The Wood's counterpart. And to me, The Wood 2.0, or whatever you want to call it, is The Best Man. I don't know why I think of The Wood and The Best Man always like in the same breath, but I do. So anyway, The Best Man, of course, another wedding story. And starring, you know, a bunch of names that we all know, some of which are overlapping with The Wood. And
in the end, your boy got married against his will, on will, basically.
And then we see what happens in the future because, you know, they had the Best Man limited series that came out not so long ago. And we got to see that, like, these couples, you know, well, one of them makes it, but yeah. Was the ending of the first movie happy or sad? So you have Lance literally crying and bawling his eyes out as he walks down the aisle thinking about his soon-to-be wife laid up with his best man. Yeah, it just is a messed up situation. But in the end, it's a wedding and they're all together. And of course, you have Harper, who's the best man, who has slept with the bride.
Yeah.
stealing the thunder at the reception, getting on his knee and proposing to his long-suffering girlfriend who becomes his long-suffering wife.
Why do they always do this where the main story isn't the main story? The main story is about Lance and them and Mia, getting married. Why is the story about Lance and is the side story the main story?
Well, sometimes I think these movies really do take on too many stories, and then you find that it's hard to really do any of them justice. On our other channel, we just finished a series on Why Did I Get Married? And I think that was one of our main critiques, was like, you're trying to tell too many stories. I mean, four couples, you know, really each couple could have almost had their own movie for each of the two movies that were done. And so sometimes I think a lot gets left on the cutting room floor when you can't fully explain like what's going on, and you know.
And I think that Taye Diggs was just a star at the time, maybe.
He was.
And I don't know, he probably could have pulled off athlete and been the star. So you just rewrite it a little bit. I don't know. But I think a lot of time writers like to write about writers. Right? So you make it about you.
Yeah, I think you could be right. You know, but you notice, like, I'm sure somebody might have done it somewhere along the way, but like, what are the most common careers of main characters in movies? And I think it's going to be like a handful of the same things that come up.
Number
all
one
over.
Is going to be like a cop.
Yeah, law, you're going to have cops,
military,
doctors, lawyers, you know, the typical stuff that people say they want to be when they grow up. You're going to have writers in there. But then in the business realm, you're going to have like ad agency execs. They're always marketing execs, you know, that kind of thing. But yeah, that's interesting. So, yeah, that's why I would say The Best Man. I mean, you know, it to me is about the same as The Wood as far as indie. You know, those movies meld together for me. But yeah, and one movie that we didn't mention yet is Waiting to Exhale. We all know the story where Bernadine has to set that car on
fire. Yeah, but how did it end?
At the end, the movie goes from New Year's to New Year's of 1 year in their life. So it ends with them all together. One of them is pregnant now. You know, one is divorced now.
Oh, pregnant with the baby daddy's married.
Yeah, with the married baby daddy. One of them finally decided to stop being a side chick and got rid of her you know, married boyfriend. And then you have one who was Gloria, who did
Gregory
find
Hines,
love with Gregory Hines, and she's happy. So that was the end of it. And I guess
happy.
I'd call it complicated yet maybe happy ending, right?
Because I think because they were kind of sad in the car, weren't they?
They weren't sad in the car, but they had been through a lot. Yeah. But maybe if you look at it as a friendship movie and not a romance movie,
that's what I'm saying.
Happy because they're all together and they're celebrating.
But you can't just be like the last 60 seconds is the happy part. Right? Because y'all just in the car, shit's messed up. Only Gloria got something good.
Only Gloria got a man.
Happy New Year.
Mm-hmm. When the relationship was clearly something that they all wanted. Because I don't want to hear in the comments, well, you ain't got to have a man to be happy. No, the characters, all of those characters wanted a man as part of their life.
Well, sometimes not getting what you want is what's best.
but it'd be like
that's
that.
Not what it was, though.
So,
that's
yeah.
not what the movie was pushing toward, or I don't know. That wasn't the gravity of the movie. That's But anyway.
Another one that we did a full movie breakdown on multiple videos and discussions is Dead Presidents. An amazing film, first of all, let me just say. But the ending where you got Anthony heading off to the penitentiary basically for the rest of his life.
Definitely for life. Yeah, that's not happy.
It is not happy at all.
That's a terrible ending.
Mm-hmm.
So, bruh, why?
Like, so for those of you who don't know, Dead Presidents is kind of the story of Anthony, who enlists volunteers as a Marine during the Vietnam War. He goes to war, and then he, you know, has these complications with his girlfriend who's become pregnant. He comes home, he's got a baby, and then he tries to make it work with her, and you know, they have their problems. And the result is that, you know, they all decide, him and his war buddies, that they need to rob a bank. And well, they weren't robbing a bank. It wasn't a bank. It was an armored truck. They're going to try to rob this armored truck in order to get money, because everybody needs money to make their life better. And it just was disastrous.
Yeah. So you had Skip. Mm-hmm. Jose died. Mm-hmm. Cleon. Or is it Clavon?
Cleon
and Kirby went to jail. Mm-hmm. The main character went to jail. And Delilah, the main characters, I guess you could call her sister-in-law, died.
Right. That just was sad. Nobody, especially Delilah.
Nobody got the money, not even like set it off.
And then in the end, you know, you see Juanita in court with the babies and whatnot, crying and whatever. And because everything is jacked up.
Yeah.
He ain't getting out.
I don't remember, like, what is it like constantly leaving a theater like this? I think that you get this feeling like, ooh, that was good, and that's a rush.
Yeah.
That you feel good about it. But when you think about it, it's not good.
You know, it's weird because some of my favorite films are ones that end in tragedy, or films that I thought were just amazing end in tragedy. And I think of even some of the more mainstream films. Like, I remember you brought up Titanic earlier, so I'll mention that. You know, it ends in tragedy to me, but of course it's, you know, they try to make it a little better in the end. She went on to live her life without Jack and all. But it was sad.
What
right?
about The Notebook?
But in The Notebook, another sad movie. I think of even older movies like Terms of Endearment and Steel Magnolias, movies that will make you, they're tearjerkers that'll make you cry. The Color Purple. But at the end of the day, when you've gone on the journey with those characters, you're just like, damn, that was good. Even if the very ending is sad. Now, The Color Purple ending, that movie was in the 80s, by the way, so don't count for this list. But, you know, you think about the ending of The Color Purple. It was happy. It was bittersweet, but yet happy, because she's reunited with her sister, who essentially was like the only person in the world who really loved her, besides, you know, Shug Avery, maybe, toward later, once they became real friends.
Yeah.
It's these movies, like, I guess it's just you walk away feeling like, man, that was great. Maybe we like torture. Maybe we like to be made sad and then made happy again in these movies. I don't know. Another movie is Fresh. We just rewatched Fresh recently.
Yeah, I did.
I fell asleep on the end. I did watch the beginning, though.
Fresh is like, it gets better every time I watch it.
Really?
Yeah, it's very, very, very good. The end is Fresh. Mike is just sitting at the table crying. That's how it ends.
Fresh is the same guy.
Oh, Sean Nelson.
Sean Nelson. The same guy that played in The Wood, and his name was Mike in there too. Big Mike. As the young Mike. But anyway. You know, Fresh, yeah. Fresh was good. Fresh was very good.
Yeah. But what did you think of the ending?
I think it made me reflect on the position that he was in for the whole movie. Like, the movies like that make me be like, this child should never have had to endure any of what he had to endure in the beginning, so that even when he gets back to the baseline, or when he quote unquote wins, it's still not a win, because it's just, I don't know. It's just making it to the status quo. It's like you're on, you know, you're in the negative and you just make it to zero.
I don't think he even made it to zero, because part of it is, I guess what they were trying to communicate was he and his sister would be in witness protection. So you have to leave even, you know, the auntie and all of that family that he knew, his daddy, who he wasn't allowed to be with, who he would meet with all the time, have to leave them.
Mm-hmm.
Just to get away from everything. Like, mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not.
That's not happy. Definitely not happy. So we have gone through a ton. I know we probably missed some. Go ahead and comment which movies that we should have talked about the ending that we didn't talk about. And maybe we'll do a video on those in the future. But all in all, I still go with the original claim that 90s hood movies never really have happy endings. And, you know, we explain why we think that's the case.
If you made it this far into this video, type Josh died, mama fired in the comments, so we'll know you're one of the real ones who stick around to the end.
Thank you so much for watching, and be sure to click on one of the videos on the screen right now. Thank you.